so quiet so fast. So I'm going to let the mayor say nice things about me now. So here is.
Tommy, can everyone hear me without a microphone? That's what I thought. Oh,
it's doing so good. I want to thank everyone for being here tonight. It is my distinct honor to have Lorri ask me to open the program tonight. I can't begin to tell you, I've got goosebumps here, because tonight is the 100th anniversary or birthday party of this amazing place. And I will tell you, I'm not sure who loves this place more, the people who work here or the people who walk through those doors. But it is a very special place for everyone under this roof. And in this digital age, where there are those who thought that this library could wither and die, it has adapted and learned to thrive and be the greatest library that we have ever seen. And let me give you some examples of how and why. Every month, 14,000 visitors walk through those doors. Amazing. Almost 40,000 people visit the library website every single month. More than 2,500 people every month take a class or engage in one of the programs that are offered here at the library. And here's one of my favorite. Every month, there are more than 3,000 service hours from volunteers who love this place as much as anybody. They have more than 100,000 books and materials right here under this roof. The Ridgewood Library has been ranked number one in children's and teen book curriculum, number one in digital book downloads, number one in media downloads. I could go on and on and on, but here is again one of my favorites. The library's ESL program has worked with people from 32 different countries around the world. This building is alive and it is magical. Let there be no mistake about it. And now, I have such a great honor to introduce my friend standing right next to me, who, believe it or not, Lorri did not start out as a librarian. She was in advertising. And in 2010, she took her first job in the library business. And it was right here at this library. She started out as the head of circulation, became the assistant director, and this year, cream always rises to the top, rose to become the director of the Ridgewood Library. And in discussing it with her, she said, and I quote, "The Ridgewood Library was the only library I ever wanted to work for, and I get to come to my dream job every single day." Please give a warm welcome to Lorri Steinbacher.
Hey, everybody. I told you he was going to say nice things about me. So it is also my great pleasure to welcome you to our 100th anniversary celebration. Before we kick this off, and everybody can hear me, right? I just wanted every single one of you to think about your favorite library memory. It may be from this library, I hope it is, or it may be from your childhood library. And probably I'd say, 20, 30% of the people in this room, that's probably the same library. Ridgewood, people come to Ridgewood and they stay. So that says a lot about the town. And I also want you to think about what the library might look like in 2123. And we can get back to that. But first, I have to give you a little bit of history. Now, I'm not normally a nervous speaker. However, history is not my strong point. And Sarah Kiefer, our local history librarian, is here. Peggy Norris, the village historian, is here. And Nancy Greene, the library director for many, many years, is here. So if I'm doing something wrong, just look to one of them, and they're probably doing this or doing this. But I'm going to try. So it's really an interesting story. In 1897, there was a group of civic-minded Ridgewood women that organized the Village Improvement Society, which, to their quote, was for the betterment of the town. And they decided, and this is a direct quote, that a town without a library was no place for them or their children, and that they better do something about it. So resident Gertrude Pease McNaughton volunteered to open a lending library at an old grain store, which was at the corner of Ridgewood Ave and South Broad Street. So they charged a couple of cents per book, and the germ of what became the Ridgewood Library started. So I just want you to consider the times. Ridgewood was all rolling hills, hay bales. The railroad had only been in town a handful of years, maybe 10, maybe 15. Women had still not won the right to vote, but they were here making a civic difference nonetheless. So to me, that also speaks a lot about what Ridgewood is and what the library is. In 1917, the population was surging. We were outgrowing the space, and it was Gertrude Pease Anderson to the rescue again. Now note the name change. There is some spicy Gertrude Pease material in the local history collection, with newspaper articles to prove it. So I would, this is not the Real Housewives of Historical Ridgewood. That's another program, but we'll continue on here. So she came to the rescue again, and she asked her executors to give $100,000 to set up a library in her father's George L. Pease's name. And the cornerstone for that library, the building that still is on Garber Square today, was laid in 1921. And on December 28, 1923, the library trustees welcomed the community through its doors. So the village population continued to grow throughout the 50s and 60s. And the head librarian at the time was Esther Baker, a great librarian name, if I do say so myself. My name, not such a great librarian name, but Esther Baker is perfect. She urged the village to renovate the Pease Library. And the townspeople petitioned instead to build a new building, and the League of Women Voters was very involved in that process as well. So in 1962, we moved into the larger building here on North Maple Ave. And Pease has done a lot of things over the years. It served as a reading room. It was a library again when we did renovations. It was the police headquarters. In the aftermath of Hurricane Floyd. And then finally, in 2008, the David Bolger and the Bolger Foundation donated money so that we could convert it to a rental space, which it still maintains its unique architectural legacy, but it also is income producing for the library. So we are thankful for that. So from all of this, when you think about the library and its role in the community, that's sort of where I wanted to start here. The library really stands as a testament to what the power of community and volunteer spirit and civic pride and what that can accomplish. Our friends of the Ridgewood Library and Foundation Group, volunteers all, continue that fine tradition with their hard work. They raise funds to supplement our operating budget and allow us to not just survive, but thrive and innovate. Since I have a captive audience, I'm sure you've always wondered, what's the difference between the Friends and Foundation? So I'm going to tell you. The Friends fund all of our programming with a particular focus on arts and culture, and the foundation funds our technology and building growth. And hopefully you had a chance to see our teen room. That's the first of five privately funded renewal projects that we have planned for this year into next year. And we have more to come. We have exciting things ahead. And we're continuing our fundraising efforts to expand the renovations to not just be the teen room, but to expand through the entire library. And hopefully, sometime down the road, this very room, our most used space. So exciting things are ahead. We're also fortunate to have a board of trustees, also volunteers, and a village council that recognizes the importance of the library and the role that we have in the community. I also would very much like to recognize the Ridgewood Library staff. They come in every day with, and I might cry, with just such a can-do attitude, willing to help and willing to just do whatever it takes. Like, this program couldn't have happened if we didn't have staff that just said, well, yeah, we can do that. And that's the attitude that we get. If you want something done, ask us, because I have a staff that will say, yeah, we can do that. And of course, like every single person in this room, I was so thrilled to see all of you here. And even people that couldn't get in the doors because this was a sellout event, all of you make up what the Ridgewood Library is. So I don't think Gertrude Pease could have imagined what her little lending library would become. And I had stats here, but the mayor stole them from me, so I'm not going to go over those again. But suffice it, I will tell you one thing, shockingly. About 10% of people never even come in the library, but they're using us nonetheless with digital materials. So I thought that was interesting. And you can do a lot of things, visit a museum, come to a repair cafe, tons of things. We're not going to go into that. What I did want to say is this. Despite technological and cultural change, our mission in 2023 is much like the mission of 1920. I'm going to read our mission statement in case you didn't know. To provide information, education, culture, and inspiration with ready and equal access to residents of all ages. A library at its finest, I think, provides both mirrors and windows. We want you to come and see yourself in our collections and in our programs, but we also want to give you a window into the greater community, into the greater world. And so everybody should be able to find themselves in this library. So I hope we're doing that. So, we change with the needs of the community, but we are about people above all, always. So that's all my history. And I think I did okay because I don't see Sarah shaking her head at me. And I would like to invite you for our full historical perspective. On Saturday, December 9th, we're having a history of Ridgewood's library with Sarah and our local historian, Peggy Norris. It's going to be very interesting. I can't guarantee the salacious piece stuff will be in there, but you might be able to get it on your way out. Now I'd like to introduce Nancy Greene, who served as director. As I'm sure you all know, she served as director from 95
till January
to 2022, and I know that she has special memories that she would like to share. Or, I mean, well, we could be here all night if she's sharing her special memories, but I'm going to pass the mic to Nancy.
Oh, good.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Can you lower it? There. Thank you. All right. Well, I never thought I was going to be back up here addressing a crowd again. This is an honor. And Lorri, thank you for inviting me to join you. Since I retired this past January, and I've been going to other libraries more often, and I realize every time I go and I say, I want to make a color copy, and they say, well, we don't have that. Or I'll say, I need to print out an attachment to my email, and they say, oh, well, you can't do it from your phone. You have to sit at a library computer and make an appointment to do that. And I just realized, like, I'm not in Oz anymore. But you all are, and I'm so glad that so many people appreciate it. Just a few thoughts, because I really want to open this up to the glitterati. When I was planning, I was hired in 95, and I had just finished planning the Mahwah Library, and that was approved, and the Ridgewood Library offered me the position, and I took it, and they said that we needed to do a new library here. And I said, well, okay, and I start researching it, and I'd gone to all these library conferences all over the country, and I said, well, what's my budget limit? And the trustees said, your job is to create the best possible library you can that will fit on this footprint. Our job is to raise the money. And can you imagine what that was like to be told, you know, don't think about the money, think about what's the best. And I think thanks to the village council and the support of the trustees and friends and foundation and all of you, we've been able to do that. So thank you all. And is Janet Fricke here tonight? Yeah, okay. I just wanted to recognize Janet Fricke was the library board president when I came on, and it was her planning and execution of the next step and the next step and the next step that got us the approval, the $4 million to do the renovations that we did and the additions that we did. So I just want to give credit where it's due. Janet, thank you. All right, so the library has had its challenges over the years, and I don't know how many times I've heard people say to me, oh, internet is making the library obsolete, or Amazon is making the library obsolete. But we have things like the local history department that Lorri mentioned, and we have our English as a second language program that Paul mentioned with the people from 32 countries. And we have services here that can't be duplicated anywhere else, that are customized for the community of Ridgewood. So it's always been easy to, you know, to rise above the challenges and keep going, because it's about the people. As Lorri said, you know, more than the books or the computers, it's the people that make the library valuable. It's the kindness of the staff. I can't tell you how many people come to the library every day, and maybe our staff is the only person or the only people that know them by name and say hi and are happy to see them, and how what an important place this is for, you know, for everybody in the community, the little kids to be recognized, but a lot of the older people that stay in the community because they feel like they have a friend here. I just wanted to say, when Lorri mentioned the staff going all out, that we've done our best during power outages, I think. From Hurricane Sandy in 2012, when the whole town lost electricity for 5 days and we had no heat, but we kept the lobby open and we dragged books out for people, and we had tables in here and it was light enough to read. So we did that. And then Hurricane, I think it was Isaias in 2020, when the town went out again. And before 9 o'clock in the morning, Charles and Johnny had wired stations outside. I don't know how you did that, Charles. Yeah. Because we had power. The entire town, but we couldn't let people in because of COVID. So that was another great thing I think that the staff did, was when COVID hit and we had to close the building, the staff turned on a dime and everything was delivered by Zoom and outside the building. And the staff was teaching Zoom to people over the phone. People would say, is the library closed? And I would say, no, the library is not closed. The building is closed. The library is open, because the library is the people. And it's bigger than the building. And most of all, it's our community. So I just wanted to say thank you. And it's my honor to introduce Sarah Kiefer. Oh, there's Sarah, our local history librarian. Thank you, everyone.
Hi, everybody. I'm Sarah Kiefer. And thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you for the introduction, Nancy. And Lorri, you did a great job with the history. So. Part of the history is all of the people that have been involved over the years. And so I just want to thank the Library Board again, Friends and Foundation, for your support, not just tonight and this year, but through all of the years. I have a whole part in my lecture that you can learn about each of their contributions. But I also want to take a moment to thank the patrons. At the opening ceremony of the George L. Pease Memorial Library, Library Trustee President Eugene Thwing, and I hope I'm saying his name correctly, said how the library had grown over the years, and the last step was to turn it over to its final owners, the people. He urged them to make it their own, to use it, and keep it alive. Ridgewood community certainly has done that over the years. And two such people that have not only kept the library alive, but helped preserve Ridgewood's history, are here with us today. I want to acknowledge Village historians Peggy Norris and Joe Saplicki. Thank you so much for all you've done, for coming tonight, and for helping guide me through all of these years. Peggy was the local history librarian who helped build the Bulger Heritage Center with a lot of other people, Nancy included. And it's now the local history and genealogy room that we're able to offer as an additional service to our community. So we have this amazing resource that allows us to provide such a unique service to the community with house histories, to genealogy research. So I urge you all to stop by. And as Lorri said, this all started out with a group of women from the Village Improvement Association who wanted to better the village by adding a library. As the town grew, so did the needs of the community for a public library. And eventually, through the will of Gertrude Pease Anderson, we were able to open the Pease Library in 1923 with the support from the community, which is the most important part. The full history that is more extensive, from the Lending Library to the Ridgewood Library, maybe I'll add in those details that Lorri mentioned, because seems like everybody's interested. It would take too much time. I'm a historian. We like to talk. We like to give you all those amazing information and details. So I hope you do join us on Saturday, December 9th at 2 p.m. for our lecture on the Ridgewood Library, celebrating 100 years of public library service. That morning, if you do have children, we do have a morning story time doing a happy birthday theme for Pease. So we welcome you all to join us on that event too. Without further ado, I'm going to turn it back to Lorri.
I'm going to do now what's called a throwback. So earlier I asked you to have your memories about the library, and I would almost bet that most of you, your memories revolved around people and experiences and had very, very little to do with books. I'm not going to call anybody out. I want you to keep those memories. They're really important. But I also want you to think about books, but really to think about the library as a place where you can come and meet your neighbors and talk, or you can learn something new, or solve a problem. We have a repair cafe, for instance. We fixed 14 lamps last month. That's 14 lamps out of a landfill. That's pretty exciting. So I want you to think about us like that, but I also want you to just consider us as a place to be inspired, whatever form that inspiration takes. So now I get to, hopefully we're gonna make some new great library memories right now. And I'm gonna hand you over to Roberta Panjwani, who is our assistant director. she's going to usher you through the rest of the program. She's worked very hard to pull this all together. She's assembled a slate of very talented people who have deep roots in Ridgewood. So what you're going to be seeing here tonight, it just really, really embodies what Ridgewood is all about and what we hope the library can bring to you now and in the future. So I'm handing it to Roberta.
Okay, thank you everyone, thank you. And it's been amazing working with Lorri in this first year and with the staff, and she's my next door neighbor. We have a connecting door, so all day long we're just having the most interesting fun, brainstorming all day long, so it's been wonderful. And this reception tonight, I have to acknowledge Lynda Koch. I don't know if Lynda's here. Where's Lynda? Lynda Koch, we've known for a long time. She just joined the Friends, and she went around to 30-some restaurants in town, just telling them they have to be part of this, and donated all of this food, all of the restaurants represented. So a huge thanks to Paul McCarthy and all of the Friends for helping us put this amazing reception together to just really start this off on a great note. So thank you. And also to Gia Dreyer, who was playing our beautiful piano music. Gia, beautiful job. And Charles is videotaping. He's recording the program tonight. We'll make that link available later this month. It's being live streamed in the teen room too, so just keep that in mind. And as Lorri said, there's so many hundreds and hundreds of partners and performers that we've worked with over the years, and we would be here all night if we invited them all, but we decided to just choose a few that have had an especially meaningful contribution to our programming and our community over the time, over the last, you know, many, many years. And I've been here since June of 2000, and it's been amazing getting to know almost every single person in this room and watching your children grow and watching them off to college and starting their own families. There's nothing more satisfying than just watching, you know, all of you grow over the years. So so this evening tonight is just such a culmination of that. So I got to look into all of my group of some of the most wonderful performers in town and just take some of them out. And basically, if you're going to celebrate anything in this world, you call Mack Brandon. So that's the first thing I did. I said, Mack is the most inspiring, uplifting connector here in town. Mack is a pastor at AME Zion Church. He's a choir director and a music professor at Ramapo College. And he does research on the intersection of music, international education, religion, and cultural political movement, which is pretty amazing. He's performed here many, many times. And tonight he is, and he became, especially during the pandemic, he really stepped up his efforts. He created all kinds of forums online and in person to really get people talking. He meets people where they are. So I have just been, it's been such a rich experience getting to know you over the years, Mack. So Mack is joined by his musicians Trinity Song, Doreen Washington, Lynda Hayes, and Tangy Major. And they're going to come up here and just start us off and welcome. And welcome to all of you.
Thank you. teacher, don't.
Yeah.
600,000 copies in 1923. Bessie Smith, The Down Are the Blues. And so, we live in this dichotomous, the secular and the sacred. We live in this diversity in the community of many one. And yet, we all sing together. I have a proposition that the definition, if you will, the definition of discord, yes, even war, is the moment that the music stops. It's the moment that we stop singing together. And so I offer to you that we should never let the music die. Never let our song be cut short. It is our bond. So let us continue to sing together. These illuminated moments of discovery in the card catalog were so connected to the music that I played, and I wanted to express a knowing that there is a deep knowing in both our learning about material and learning about each other. And so in the 5 minutes that I was allotted, I just want to I just want to offer to you a hearty congratulations. I have told, and I have watched her up close and personal, because I, as I said, I'm a librarian kid. Roberta is the most unbelievable librarian. And I know some people know I put my hoodie on and I come up and I study, you know, I study, and I'm sitting in power, the internet went off. This happened a couple months ago, I think. And the internet went off, and Roberta was scurrying. She was going to every person who was studying, offering them so that they would have internet. Each person in the library, she was offering that. I said, Roberta, you get the gold prize. And so it's just an honor to be with you. I just thank you so much for allowing us to be together in our short time. And I want to offer you, don't ever stop singing. Don't ever stop singing your songs. Here.
Okay, so Mack mentioned that he lives in the 700s music performing arts section, and our next
guest tonight, Robert Sean Leonard, I've seen him in the 800s a lot. That is poetry, theater, literature, those are the 800s, and then he can be seen sometimes upstairs in the fiction, and of course with his family down in Children's, but it's always fun, like he's the real deal. He really loves this library. It's always so much fun to see him coming in. So many of you know Robert from, you know, Dead Poets Society and Age of Innocence, Much Ado About Nothing, over 45 plus film and television credits. He was in House, The Next Generation Knows Him, and the upcoming season 2 of The Gilded Age. So Cynthia Nixon's character finally has some fun, I think, in the next season. He's worked alongside in theater. He's a Tony, multiple Tony Award-winning actor and Tony Award-winning actor. He's been seen in Arcadia and this amazing production of Long Day's Journey and Tonight with Vanessa Redgrave, Brian Dennehy, Philip Seymour Hoffman. And Robert was a guest on our podcast a few months ago. And I think we talked about that for maybe 20 minutes. So you indulged me in that. It was fun. So just thank you so much for being so involved with the library. And I just, so when we wanted to invite him to come, he not only said yes, but he met with Diane and myself, I think 2 Wednesday nights, and we ate pizza and like talked for 3 hours and finally got to the program part. But we just talked theater and books, and it was just so much fun. So Robert, thank you so much. Robert's going to share some memories later on in the program, but he's going to start tonight by doing a reading by Diana Abdu-Jabbar called The Sun and the Moon. So welcome, Robert.
I need something between me and the audience. Always. I recommend it. Thank you all for letting me be a part of this tonight. Roberta sent me this. I don't even know what this is. I guess it's, I mean, I really don't know what it is. It's not an essay. It sounds terrifying. It's just like a little... All right. Thank you for coming. Good night. All right. Anyway, I love this, and I have no idea what it is. It's called The Sun and the Moon. At the beach, the sunlit water is sapphire. The ghosts of spring breakers past still dance on tabletops. But further inland, the library knows another Fort Lauderdale. 7 years ago, I gave a reading at the main library. They served mint tea and baklava. Most of my book tour happened in bookstores, but in Fort Lauderdale, the borders had shuttered and the indies had dwindled away, so the library had stepped in to reclaim the town's literary identity. Here were workshops and author appearances. Each year, they sponsored a book festival. The downtown building stands near the railroad tracks that divide Florida's East Coast into economic and racial partitions. It attracts travelers, nomads, refugees from both sides of the tracks. A few years after that first reading that I gave, my daughter and I met up on the library steps with some other parents and children. We were tired and hot, happy to get into the air conditioning. There were the usual enticements, books, of course, and computers. Toys, chess set, child-sized pieces. And then we heard the library had a moon rock on display. From the actual moon? The children cried. We searched the library several floors before spotting the display. The rock was small, gray, and unassuming. That's it? They said. But at bedtime that evening, I reminded my daughter, just think, our library holds part of the moon. Wonder moved through her face, and she nodded gravely. Let's go back tomorrow. When you hear Fort Lauderdale, literature might not be the first thing that springs to mind. In this land of tanned bodies and jello shots, the library whispers. Free of charge, it offers us the weight of starlight, the light of the moon, and the music of uninterrupted imagination.
Good evening, Ridgewood. I'm Willie Geist, RHS class of 93, and Glen Elementary School class of 86. I'm not sure what it says about our class, but they literally closed Glen School immediately after we graduated. When my family moved to Ridgewood from Chicago in 1980, midway through my kindergarten year, I remember distinctly walking into that big, beautiful library for the first time. I remember the smell of books, that crinkle of the plastic on the covers, and of course, the wonderful librarians who guided me through those stacks filled with adventure. In the years that followed, the books I checked out got a little more sophisticated. The microfiche machines helped me write high school papers. Do they still have those? And always, the wonderful librarians were there to help. The Ridgewood Library has been a great source of pride, the center of our community, for 100 years, so you deserve a great birthday party tonight. I encourage all of you to celebrate just as we did as teenagers, sneaking Bartles and James wine coolers right back there behind the band shell. It's a good spot. Happy birthday.
Okay. So now we have some dance. When many of you have seen Lynn Needle perform and present, and when you ask her to do something, it's done in such, she just immerses herself in the endeavor, and it's done with such detail and with such joy, and it's very theatrical. It's been so amazing to watch Lynn and her dancers prepare for this. Lynn is the founder, artistic director of Art of Motion Incorporated, which is right here in town. It was founded in 2002. It's a nonprofit educational and cultural organization, and it's home to the Art of Motion Dance Theater. And like Robert Mack, Lynn also provides so much to the community, just giving her talent and her time to so many people who are interested in dance and the arts. And tonight, Lynn is joined by dancers Janette, Dishuk, and Courtney, Karam, and they're performing a piece called Forest, which is an excerpt from a full evening work entitled Heaven and Earth. It's a nature myth, and she's performed this at Lincoln Center, Jacob's Pillow, and many colleges and universities. And it's a very personal endeavor, this piece, and Lynn will tell us a little bit about it, but it has very apt themes for the library and the community. So Lynn, we are so pleased to have you here, and we hope you enjoy Forest.
Good evening, and thank you to Roberta and Lorri for this beautifully curated evening, and for all of you for being here tonight to celebrate this magical anniversary, a centennial. It's quite remarkable. So I wanted to share, so much went into deciding what the ingredients were going to be in this beautiful presentation. And I wanted to kind of honor the beauty, I think many of us have them in our homes, of coffee table books, right? There's so many different kinds of books. And my husband and I and my son, who is now in San Diego, I'm a proud grandmother of two little girls. So my husband and I have had a life here for more than 35 years. And like so many of us tonight, one of the first places we came when we came to town, of course, was the library. So I just love seeing the library morph and grow and change and evolve during the period of time that we've lived in Ridgewood. So thank you to everyone here that made that journey happen. This beautiful book, The Hidden Life of Trees by Peter Wohlleben, perhaps you've heard of it, if not, the library has it, so you can come and borrow it. But it sort of embraces, I think, the importance of all of us and who we are and how important nature is and how there's a constant conflict between man and nature, but nature seems to always win, right? So when we talked about what we might perform on this special stage, we decided that Forest might be a wonderful choice, and my maiden name, Lynn Lesniak, translates in Polish, Lesniak in Polish, means forest. So the origin and the context and the birth of the piece, because as we all know, as artists and creators and as people, even if you're a cook, it all begins with a seed. It begins with an ingredient. So when I started working on this piece about more than a dozen years ago in 2010, I was in class. It was a very organic moment. And our ballet teacher, my artistic associate, Olivia Galgano, who's 20 years older than I, very seasoned ballet dancer, like an encyclopedia of ballet, classical ballet. And she came in and she had these point shoes. And they were given to her. They were used, upcycled. And she gave them to me and she said, I just thought of you. And it was such a random moment, an organic random moment. And after class was over, I sat in the corner and I tried them on and they fit. And it was really a very personal Cinderella moment for me to be given something like that and actually have them fit, because I hadn't had point shoes on over 25 years. That's true. So I spent time in the studio alone experimenting with them to see, because I'm a modern dancer, I'm not a classical dancer, even though we train in classical dance to maintain our range of motion and our strength. And then another colleague of mine, we called her Juilliard Sally. Sally Simpson graduated from Juilliard in the dance division and was married to a Juilliard musician, Scott Simpson. And in their marriage, they had saved and saved and saved for a used car. And they had just gotten their first used car. And she came to work to teach the very next day after I was given the point shoes. And she said, Lynn, in the used car when I was driving home, there was a CD in the car, and the music was incredible. It was just so incredible, and you just have to do something with this. And she handed me a CD, like a Frisbee, you know, and she said, here, listen to this. And it's the music that you'll hear tonight from the Nareda label, Equinox. It's by David Lanz and Paul Spear. So again, another random impromptu moment where a gift really gave birth to a piece. As I started to create the work and tried to experiment with somewhat autobiographical material, it brings to mind the beauty of the Bulger Legacy Center here at the library, that you can all research your family trees and your legacy to further your education about where your roots are and where you came from. So I hope that you can celebrate the roots of the trees. This particular book really honors what they refer to as the wood wide web. So I'll let you ponder that. And I'll be joined by Janette and Courtney to perform Forest. Thank you for having us. Thank you.
So next up, my very good friend, Diane Carlin Sims. Many of you have seen her performing in bands all over town and many times here at the library. And I first met her back in 2002 when I was first starting the Real Voices Documentary Film Festival sponsored by the Friends. And Diane was on the first committee, and I was just blown away by the deep knowledge she had of the arts and her amazing organizational skills. And it became very evident that we were going to do a lot of great things for the library together. Diane is, she is out of the College of Visual and Performing Arts at Syracuse University. And she's a trained actor, and she's a singer-songwriter. And it's just been amazing. Every time we kind of brainstorm with the staff and the Friends on new initiatives, I immediately called Diane and things really happened. She was the co-founder with me and artistic director of the On Book Play Reading Series. Right here on the stage we did four different plays with a full cast, and it was just amazing. Her passion is poetry. She started at the This Is a Poem celebration, multimedia celebration. The initial program was last spring, and we're definitely going to bring it back. That will now be an annual program. Many Friends members events, and most recently, we started the Bend in the Road podcast together. And it's been amazing to have these conversations and have the library's message and mission really go beyond the walls of this building. So, of course, when I called her, just like everyone else, immediately it turned into a party and a conversation and brainstorming and putting this all together. So it's been such a joy to have this event be our most recent collaboration. And Diane is going to share a little bit about her memories here at the library. And then, of course, she's going to share a beautiful poem with us. So welcome.
Hi, everybody. Nobody told me you could bring backup singers. And thank you for warming up our voices. And thank you, Roberta, for that. I love you, too. So, I read a news article not too long ago about a group of garbage collectors in Turkey. They were going about their business, and one day they realized they were picking up a lot of discarded books on their daily route. And so someone broached the idea of salvaging and rescuing these books. A conversation was had. An idea was born that they should take these books and create a library. On the one hand, they said, there were those who were leaving these books on the streets. On the other hand, there were those who were looking for them. And so it began, a seed of an idea that began with a conversation between these local garbage collectors and ended with them initiating an offering for their community. Let's see what's on the other side of this, they said. I was so moved by this story. It stayed with me. Why? Well, first of all, the unlikely prospect of these workers stepping outside of their perfunctory duties long enough to recognize the value of these books, and the spot-on recognition of something that could benefit their community. Beautiful. A gift of love of some kind and everyday heroes. And so here we are. Here we are. And 100 years here. The Ridgewood Public Library. And I have to say, it made me think, what was there before? And Lorri, thank you for the history. It was beautiful to hear what was here before. But the question was asked, and a conversation began. This town needs a library. This town deserves a library. Get this going. For the love of books, for the love of words, for the love of community. They initiated this enterprise to lift and propel us forward. And you know, anything can be made, but someone has to start it. Everyday heroes in my book. So as for me, I was born in a small town in New Hampshire, Keene, New Hampshire. My mother newly immigrated to the States and with five children in tow, knew enough to walk us down the long main street to the beautiful edifice that was our local library and unleash us all. This is my earliest memory of a library. Wonder, magic, welcome, discovery. What do you want to know? What world do you want to see? And walking home with a bag of books. I mean, what was that? To me, it was an act of love. Fast forward, I'm new in Ridgewood with my own four little sprouts in tow. And one of the first things I did was look for the library. And I knew what a library could offer, but I didn't know what this library would offer. Delicious discovery, once again. And what gratitude I have for every minute we spent, four small children in all the story times, doing the reading challenges, if anyone remembers that. We had them pasted to the refrigerator. And supporting RPL with my ever-present late fees, which I will say, worth it, worth it, worth it. So the library has given me so much. I met Roberta many moons ago, as she said, when she was starting the documentary film festival, Real Voices. And in true form, she was roping in every willing volunteer she could find, enter me, and others, many others. And then she and the friends and the library board have been so supportive with projects that I've been just so proud to be a part of and put together. The Play Reading series, as Roberta said, on book, the library podcast, Bend in the Road, which Roberta's shepherding beautifully these days. And this past summer, our inaugural multimedia poetry reading presentation, This is a Poem. Food for the soul, all of it. So, you know, we spend our lives keeping up with our lives, trying to make sense of the din and the noise, hoping to not miss what's important in these fleeting moments, to recognize all of what we have that is good. And so, gratitude for a conversation that happened 100 years ago, and gratitude to those of you who are propelling it forward. Some of my closest friends work here at the library, some of the best people I know, and you are all the guardians of something precious in this community. Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to finish by reading a poem, of course, by the great Elizabeth Alexander called Praise Song for the Day. I would like to read this because I think it speaks to the soul of the everyday and how the everyday can become the extraordinary and how it's important to recognize and to give with love. And I feel this is what the library is. Praise Song for the Day. Praise Song for the Day by Elizabeth Alexander. Each day, we go about our business, walking past each other, catching each other's eyes or not, about to speak or speaking. All about us is noise. All about us is noise and bramble, thorn and din, each one of us with our ancestors on our tongues. Someone is stitching a hem, darning a hole in a uniform, patching a tire, repairing things in need of repair. Someone is trying to make music somewhere with a pair of wooden spoons on an oil drum with cello, boombox, harmonica, voice. A woman and her son wait for the bus. A farmer considers the sky. A teacher says, take out your pencil, begin. We encounter each other in words, words spiny or smooth, whispered or declaimed, words to consider, reconsider. We cross dirt roads and highways that mark the will of someone and then others who said, I need to see what's on the other side. I know there's something better down the road. We need to find a place where we are safe. We walk into that which we cannot see. Say it plain, that many have died for this day. Sing the names of the dead who brought us here, who laid the train tracks, raised the bridges, picked the cotton and the lettuce, built brick by brick the glittering edifices they would then keep clean and work inside of. Praise song for struggle. Praise song for the day. Praise song for every hand-lettered sign, the figuring it out at the kitchen table. Some live by love thy neighbor as thyself. Others by first do no harm or take no more than you need. What if the mightiest of these is love? Love beyond marital, filial, national. Love that casts a widening pool of light. Love with no need to preempt grievance. In today's sharp sparkle, this winter air, anything can be made, any sentence begun, on the brink, on the brim, on the cusp. Praise song for walking forward in that light. Congratulations to Ridgewood Library on 100 years, and here's to walking forward into 100 more.
Thank you, Diane. It's wonderful. Okay, we have next up. We have Sherma Andrews, and I know many of you have seen her at some of the biggest events in Ridgewood, and she has performed also on this stage many times. And it's Sherma. You have such a cool origin story. You were born in Trinidad and Tobago, and a child prodigy. And you were the youngest of all of the siblings, and you basically decided that you were going to be a messenger of hope from age 4, age 7. You were going to use your gift and your instrument and really give back to the community. That was your family's edict. So Sherma is a singer, songwriter, recording artist, pianist, and graduate and former faculty member at Boston's Berklee College of Music. And she has performed all over the world and in 40 of the United States, and at many venues like Lincoln Center, Madison Square Garden, Lincoln Center, Bergen Pack, and so forth. And I understand that you have a song that was featured in The Sopranos. Is that true? Well that's most of it.
And what song was at The Sopranos? That's so interesting.
Oh, I'm sorry, we had to take a detour on that.
By the way, this is my, I told Diane this all the time. My dream is to stand here with the microphone and sing.
That's why I do what I do. I try to get you on here, I think. So Sherma she covers some of the legendary women of song, Aretha Franklin, Whitney Houston, Etta James, Billie Holiday, and Beyonce, literally every genre, and so beautifully. And tonight, I know Mack again, you covered Dan Hart's Blues, and I said, can we do something from 1923, and it's going to be so interesting to hear your take on that, too. So Sherma, thank you so much for being here. Your gift is such a gift to all of us. And thank you for just using your gift to give back to the community. It makes such a difference to us. So welcome, Sherma. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. You know, we've had so much fun on this stage, haven't we? And what I love love about this atmosphere. Anything goes. And actually, I do remember just having that feeling on my last show. And I was just tossing candy. And everybody was just grabbing candy. It was so funny. But thinking about the library and the fact that it's done so much for all of us, I'm thinking about a specific memory when my daughter, Taylor, who's here with her best friend, Olivia, she had a very interesting task. Do you remember this task, Taylor? She had to read to a doll. And it was so much fun. In fact, I think the doll was really paying attention. And I must say, he did a better job than I did. And just thinking about 100 years ago, this beautiful song that Reverend Mack touched on earlier, Bessie Smith. Just picture Bessie Smith coming up with this downhearted blues. And you know, ladies and gentlemen, the blues is something really, it's not to smile about. It's dark. It's sad. But you know what it does, though? It exhilarates. It releases. And that's what I like about using this particular song. Because it's the time when, yes, the library was born, but it's also a birth of the soul. Think about it. Here we go.
Trouble, trouble.
is present. How do we sing the blues? It's just a slight difference, right? Still bluesy, but it's a little brighter, I think.
dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind.
Welcome back.
Yes.
this, I'll die. I feel like Chuck Barris. Thank you. Sorry, I just need a sec. That seems all right. I don't know. Is there light here? Don't ever follow Sherma Andrews doing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. I think my mom told me that a few years ago. I've met with Roberta, with Diane, and we talked so much about this, and it didn't even occur to me that that going on late in the evening, in an evening of celebrating something, centenary of the existence of something, that the facts of the place and the history of the place and why it's great would have all been covered. Why didn't I think of that? So I, you know, the Warner Brothers established their company in 1923, and you know, and yet when I go to Tito's Burritos, I walk under the marquee with their last name right there. You know, I was going to talk about that, but it's horrible. So I can't talk about any of this. I wrote stuff about the library, and I, you know, like made a rough draft and worked on it, and it was pretty good. But now it's just meaningless because it was all sort of, you know, the George Pease and the 400,000 items in circulation every year, and the thousands of programs for adults and you guys are tired. Who cares? I'll tell you about something that I did mention to them, and it's quick. It happened right behind you, about maybe 50 or 60 yards behind you in the children's section a few months ago to me. And after Somewhere Over the Rainbow, it's, what can you do? So I'll do this. I don't know how to do this. Okay, so my version of the history is in 1937, a unlikely named man, Thornton from Madison, Wisconsin, wrote a deceptively simple little play called Our Town in 1937. So that was 14 years after the birth of the library. Has no connection. But there you have it. So he wrote this play called Our Town. Edward Albee once referred to this play as the greatest American play ever written. That has no relevance at all. I just think it's great that he said it. And also I happen to agree. And I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with the play. But to support what I'm about to tell you, which happened in the children's section, I just want to recount one moment from the play. Act three begins of Our Town in a cemetery. I don't know if you recall, or for those of you who don't know the play at all, it's in a cemetery, and it's very striking and strange, because the first two acts are very homey, and suddenly it's just stark, and it's in a cemetery. And Emily Webb, who's a woman we've come to love, has died giving birth to her second child, and she sits in a straight-backed chair that represents her grave, and she's surrounded by other members of Grover's Corners who've passed away since we last visited them in Act Two. Years have passed. And she wants to go back and relive a day of her life. And her mother-in-law, who's next to her, which always sounds strange, warns her not to do it, that it's a mistake, that she'll regret it, but she insists on it. And the stage manager, the sort of mysterious stage manager character who Thornton Wilder creates to sort of guide us through the play, whips her back through time to relive her 12th birthday. And the problem is she has to relive this morning as her 12-year-old self on that day, and also very much her older post-life self. So she has to be 12 with her parents and then throw comments as the older Emily back to the stage manager. It's an incredibly fun thing to watch as an audience member, but she realizes very quickly why she was warned. Thornton Wilder made a very clear note that the other two characters, the mother and father, should never make eye contact with the actor playing Emily throughout the scene. Incredibly smart direction. And after a while, Emily gives up. At one point, she looks at her mom and says, "Oh, Mama, look at me for one moment as if you really saw me." And she says to the stage manager, I can't go on. It goes so fast. I might be paraphrasing. It goes so fast, we don't have time to look at one another. Do any human beings realize life while they live it? Every minute. And the stage manager simply says, no. And he's right, of course. So I moved here in 1973. I was 4 years old, which was weirdly 50 years ago. But I came here. My mom told me, this was, as Diane said, the first place my mom brought us as kids, three of us, when we moved to Ridgewood from Washington Township. And I came here. Anyway, 3 months ago, I was running an errand in town. And my daughter, my middle daughter, called me to pick her up. She said, "Can you pick me up? I'm at the library studying with friends. Can you pick me up?" And I said, "Sure." And I came by and I walked in and I couldn't find her and I was walking around. I assumed she'd be up in the fiction area. It's kind of cool up there, but not, the tables aren't big enough. I realized that was a mistake. She was in the children's section with her friends and I walked in and but she didn't notice that I'd walked in. And I don't know if you know, feel this way, but I feel like when there's something so extraordinary about watching your kids in public when they don't know you're there at a certain age, because the way they talk or laugh or just lean in and kind of whack their friend and move, and they're who they are, but they're slightly different than the kid in your house. And it's just a feeling, I don't know. I don't know any other feeling like it. It's like you feel thrilled and lonely at the same time. Very strange. But anyway, I was just watching her. And it just happened. It was overwhelming. I had it was Thornton Wilder just ringing my bell from the great beyond. I grew up here. And on autumn nights almost 50 years ago, I sat where she was sitting. And I studied with my friends too. And to realize something is to see it, to realize it something fully, to see it clearly. And so when Emily says, "Do any human beings realize life every minute?" Of course not, but there are moments. And that was a moment for me. And it doesn't come often. I think it's something Emily Webb would have liked. And I think there's a reason that it happened here and not at Starbucks or Walgreens. And I think that's the reason I'm here tonight. So that's it. That's what I'm going to say. Thank you guys for coming so much. I'm glad I came too. Roberta.
Okay. Lorri, are you around? Is Lorri here? Oh. We're a comedy team. We plan this. Yeah. So we have one more performance this evening, and we just wanted to say thank you all for coming. We just wanted to end on the dance note and not have any more speechifying. So this is the last speechify you'll hear. Thank you all for coming. This has been such a wonderful evening, and I hope to see you back the next 100 years. Thank you. Okay. Okay. So, Robert, it's so apt that you kind of talked about high school in that era, because we are ending on that note. We talked about the last 100 years, and we are ending on the future. These amazing Ridgewood High School, these are dancers that are preparing for the Asian Festival, which takes place in March. And that's a long time away. And when I spoke with the advisor, Maida Karatani, she said, well, I don't know. You know, we're just getting to know each other now. But she brought up the idea to the students, and they immediately said, yes, yes, yes. And they put this together on their own. And it's been amazing to watch them rehearse over the last couple of days. It's just extraordinary. So the Asian Festival, it was founded by Helen Aslanides at the high school, and then Maida took it over about 10 years ago. And it's basically, it's a celebration of cultures within the Ridgewood community, featuring visual and performing arts from China, India, Japan, Korea, and the Philippines. So they have put together this really wonderful kind of celebration to close out our evening. And I want to add my thanks to Lorri's, just thanks to each and every one of you for all that you do to keep this mission alive. And like she said, we just love coming to work every day, and it's just always so exciting. So thank you for coming, and please welcome the Ridgewood High School Asian Fest dancers.